So let's talk about sea stars today, shall we? Sea stars are surprisingly fascinating, but unsurprisingly, most people don't know anything about them, probably because arguably the most famous one isn't exactly known for being particularly compelling. So let's get a little background on these guys, clear up some common misconceptions, as it were. First off, sea stars are animals. I say this because in the past I have been surprised to find out that some people don't realize that they're animals, but there they are, solid on a branch on the tree that is the kingdom of Animalia. They're part of the phylum right here, Echinodermata, a group of animals which includes other creatures like sea cucumbers, sand dollars, brittle stars, sea lilies, and sea urchins. They're found in oceans all over the world, from very shallow water to very, very deep water, and sometimes not even in water at all, but we'll get back to that later. Sea stars are also very, very old. The earliest fossils we have of them date all the way back to 450 million years ago, but they could be even older, given that they don't fossilize well because their bodies are soft. Side note, I find it kind of frustrating when people are talking about fossils and they throw out these huge numbers that have no real context and don't really mean anything. I mean, what is 450 million years ago? What does that even mean? What was happening then that was different from what was happening 300 million years ago, or 65 million years ago, or 1,000 million years ago? I feel that numbers this huge need to be given some frame of reference so that we have a better understanding of what they mean. So here's my attempt to provide a very small amount of context. 450 million years ago is before the dinosaurs, it's before the formation of the supercontinent Pangaea, and it's before plants started showing up on land. Wait, no, that's wrong. It's before fish showed up in the ocean? Nope, that's incorrect. It has to be before animals started showing up on land. Nope, I suppose I was wrong there as well. Are they at least older than sharks? Okay, great. Sea stars are older than sharks. There we go. More context. If you knew that sharks were really old, because sharks are really old. They've been around for a really long time. I don't know if that's actually common knowledge. I don't even know if this was very helpful. Let's just move on. And lastly, and quite possibly the most surprising, sea stars are carnivorous predators. So like that guy. And like these guys. Which is a weird thought, given that sea stars have no eyes, no jaws, and no real noticeable amount of speed to speak of, but just like these guys, sea stars depend on consuming the living flesh of other animals in order to survive. But their diet is pretty limited. They can only really eat prey that basically doesn't move. Fortunately, there's a bunch of animals like that in the ocean. Sea stars like to eat a lot of bivalves, like mussels, clams, and oysters. They like to eat sponges, which are also animals. Some are fast enough to catch snails, and if you're a jerk, like the crown of thorn sea star, you eat coral polyps and do damage to reefs. Sea stars don't eat like any other animal on planet Earth, and it's not terribly obvious how they do it just by looking at them? Sea stars, for lack of a better phrase, have to literally self-eviscerate in order to consume something. And in case you're wondering what that means, I have a video here from the Vancouver Aquarium, and I've linked to the full video in the description if you want to watch it. So this is a sunflower star. By the way, sunflower stars are one of the largest and fastest species of sea star in the ocean. Their arm span can get up to be a meter across, and they clock in at the most remarkable speed of 1 meter per minute. But this is a sunflower star being fed a clam, and this hole right here in the center of all its arms is its mouth, and if we just wait a second, you can see this silky white pillowy looking thing that's coming out of its body, and that is the sea star's stomach. They literally push a whole entire organ outside of their body to utilize it. We aren't going to be able to see much in a second because the sea star is going to fold in half, but from here, the sea star will wrap its stomach around the clam, release a bunch of digestive juices so that the clam kind of turns into a sort of soup, and then slurp the soup into its stomach, and then slurp its stomach back into its body. Sea stars are the only animal in the entire animal kingdom that regularly disembowel themselves in order to survive. I'm going to repeat that because I think it bears repeating. Sea stars are the only animal in the entire animal kingdom that regularly disembowel themselves in order to survive. See, these guys still gotta bite their food and swallow it. Like chumps. I first learned this fact about sea stars when I was 7 years old, and to this day, I still think it's one of the craziest things I've ever learned about an animal that lives in the ocean, and let me tell you, there are some crazy animals that live in the ocean. Also, just for clarification, sea stars cannot eat the shells of shellfish, they can only eat the meaty bits, but what sea stars lack in speed, they definitely make up for in strength, because they can pry open bivalves just by wrapping their arms around them and using brute force to open them up. And they don't even need to open it all the way, their stomach is so squishy and flexible, that they only need to open the bivalve shell a fraction of a millimeter, and I'm not even exaggerating there. Source! And remember how I said that sometimes you can find sea stars outside of the water? Some species are so tough that they can bust open bivalves without being underwater. It can take a long time, and if they don't do it fast enough, they might die of desiccation, but they can do it. The last thing I wanted to talk about is how important sea stars are, which means we need to talk about keystone species. A keystone species is defined as a species that has a disproportionately large effect on its environment relative to its abundance, which basically means even though a keystone species makes up only a small percentage of the total population in an ecosystem, their presence, or lack thereof, can completely change the way an ecosystem functions. Noted zoologist Robert T. Payne was a scientist who discovered keystone species from his studies on sea stars. He did this by studying an area called the Rocky Intertidal Zone, which is one of the most diverse and productive ecosystems in the world. It's home to countless numbers of different species, from tiny snails and limpets, to big gorgeous sea anemones, to lots of different kinds of algae, to thousands and thousands of other kinds of organisms. To study keystone species, Professor Robert T. Payne went into an area of the Rocky Intertidal Zone and removed all the sea stars, knowing that they were the primary predator of mussels, and watched to see what happened. When he returned a few weeks later, the area where he had removed the sea stars had been completely overrun by mussels and barnacles, and a few weeks after that, mussels had taken over nearly everything. They had killed, pushed out, evicted, squashed, and starved nearly all other organisms in their area, but thanks to the diligent work of an animal that, at first glance, and probably several glances after that, doesn't really seem like it's capable of doing much, the Rocky Intertidal Zone still gets to hold the title of being one of the most diverse places on Earth. Thank you so much for watching the very first episode of Alien Ocean. I want to give two special thanks in particular, one to my friend Bryan, who made my wonderful YouTube avatar. I absolutely adore it. It is so cute. So thank you, Bryan, for taking time out of your busy schedule to make that for me. I really appreciate it. I also want to give a really special thanks to my dear older brother, Shea. The biggest reason I was actually able to complete the video this time, despite many previous attempts, was because he taught me how to edit videos in Adobe Premiere. He also provided a ton of very valuable feedback, and without him, I don't think this video would have been anywhere near as good as it is. At least I think it's good. I hope y'all think the same. So thank you, Shay. He and my friend Bryan actually have their own YouTube channel. It's called Scribble Zone, so you should go check it out. If you like my humor, I think you would like their humor as well. So yeah, tune in next time. We'll be talking about moray eels. And until then, this has been your friendly neighborhood octopus lady, reminding you that you don't need to go into space to find aliens.
We should take my stomach
and push it somewhere else!